watching through Facebook Live. Welcome to Elson Family Church. I know many of you guys know me here in the building, but also on Facebook. My name is Angela Hunt. I serve on staff here at Elson Family Church with Pastor Randy and, well, Ron. And some of the others on the worship team. So we just, you know, want to introduce ourselves and connect with you guys. A couple of announcements. We've kind of been a little announcement free for the last couple of weeks, really since the blood drive, but we are beginning to ramp up for Christmas. Christmas 2020, like everything else in 2020, is probably going to be something completely different, right? But we do still have the opportunity to serve so many families in our community in a couple different ways. So for those that are here in the building and those online, we do have opportunity to sign up for Christmas for Everyone, where families in the community that may not have a lot of options financially to provide Christmas for their kids can sign up, and then we actually help them get some gifts, and we give them some gifts, and we send home some soup and all kinds of good stuff with them. They actually come here and we get to interact with them. It's a great opportunity to meet others in our community and minister with them and just love on them. So those signups are here. You can also email the office at elsonfamily@elsonfamily.org. And I will connect you with Kim Pfeiffer and Angela McBride, who are overseeing that. The other opportunity that we started last year and are continuing again this year is Angel Tree. And the ministry of Angel Tree is a little different than Christmas for Everyone. Angel Tree is a ministry that started out of prison fellowship. So many families in our community here in Tippecanoe County are impacted by a mom, dad, or step-parent that is serving time in prison. And this is an opportunity where we get to come alongside that inmate and provide a gift from that inmate to their child. And it's I had the opportunity, and I think one or two of my kids came along with me to deliver those gifts. And for many of them, it's unexpected. A lot of these kids may have not seen that parent in a really long time and may not see that parent again for a really long time. And it's just a way to build that connection and keep that connection with home, but also a way for our church to come around that family should that inmate come home. They have a church name. They have some faces of people that have come to their home. So if you have some interest in that, I sent an email out to those that we have email addresses to. Beth Faulkner sort of oversees that. She would be your primary contact. Again, you're welcome to check in with me or email the office, elsonfamily@elsonfamily.org. I get those on my phone, so it'll be fine. We'll get in touch with you very quickly if you have any questions about those. One final note, and I promise I will hand it over to worship because it is so good this morning. I've listened to it now twice during practice and then first service. It's really good. I just wanted to touch base with everyone here about the whole COVID thing, right? We're hearing more about it. It's continuing to be in the news. Again, you know, we're seeing a lot of different, you know, more numbers and positive cases and more hospitalizations, and certainly COVID is a real thing. And many of our students have already been quarantined or no longer in school, and there's all this, what do I do? What do I do? That I think I answered that 6 different times just on Friday afternoon. What do I do if my kid's quarantined? Well, if your kid's quarantined, keep your kid home. And if they're not having symptoms, you can probably come, but keep your kid home. Or if you're quarantined or you're having symptoms, we love you, and we will pray for you if you let us know, but stay home. You can still watch us online and still keep in touch with us through email and phone calls and all that really great stuff, okay? So it is okay. One of the things that I encouraged our Celebrate Recovery attendees on Fridays is there's no safer people or safer place in the world than the church. I believe that. So if that happens in your family and your family's directly impacted by COVID, we want to come alongside of you in that. Because keeping that to yourself opens the door for a lot of fear. And the enemy is operating, not having to work real hard in all of that fear. So please touch base with us so that we can come alongside of you in prayer. And if you need something, we can be aware of that. But also that you would not ever be afraid on your own. You know what I'm saying? So just let us know. Touch base with us. And if you have any questions or concerns about what's happening here through the week on Sundays, again, we are happy to walk through those conversations as well as staff and certainly as Pastor Randy. So having said all of that, I'm going to hand this over to our worship team.
Make sure everything's unmuted before we get going. You guys can stand. Hebrews 4:12 tells us that God's word is alive and active. What's really, really good about that is that God's word that he's already revealed to us will still speak to us. Even though our situations change, what we face changes, the word can still speak to us. So I want to encourage you this morning. I don't know what it is you're facing, what you're dealing with, what's in the back of your mind that you're trying to forget about right now. But I want to encourage you while we go into worship. And if you get into God's presence, if you get into God's word, he will speak to that situation. He will speak over that situation. So let's just open our hearts to him this morning and welcome him to be here with us and to speak to us, to speak over our situations as we worship him.
We will not tremble, we won't be afraid.
powers against him will fall. For our God is stronger, he can do all things. No higher name, no higher name we can call. For Jesus is greater, we can do all. Trust in you. Yes, we trust in you. Cause you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all. Perfect. Thank you.
speak be so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love as you call.
And in that tender whisper, God, we hear a voice from a sovereign and holy God that says, do not be afraid. To be still and know that you, Father, our loving and good Father, is God. That you know all things, that you are all things, that you are our refuge and our strength. And that in spite of everything happening around us, we will not be shaken as we keep our feet planted on the truth of your word, the foundation of your love, the rock of our salvation, and our eyes as your church and as brothers and sisters with Christ, our eyes on you. So, Father, we boldly and yet profoundly, humbly come before you, worshiping your great name, worshiping all that you are, so that we can be loud about our faith, so that we can be loud about your love for us and for the world, because there are those out there that don't know you yet. So, Father, we thank you for this place to come to. We thank you for the technology that allows us to touch our family and those out around in the community and in the world and in this country. We love you, and indeed, we worship a sovereign, a holy, a just, and a good God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
take my life, I'm letting go. I lift it up to you whose throne.
Let's sing that again, take my heart.
Take my heart, I lay it down at the feet of you who's crowned. Take my life, I'm letting go. I lift it up to you whose throne. I will worship. We trust in you, God, in your unfailing love. We will not be shaken because you're a perfect God. So if you're so perfect, why is all this mess in my life? And why is all this chaos in my life? What in the world is going on? I feel like the Lord is challenging us this morning in this song to just simply say to us, are you still going to bow your knee before me, even in the midst of the trial and the tribulation? Are you going to worship me, or are you going to worship fear? Are you going to worship me, or are you going to worship? What are you going to worship? What are you going to bow your knee to? Is it just you and me? In the midst of all of that's going on, is it just you and me? Just you and me here now. Only you and me here now. It's just you and me here now. Only you and me here now. Just you and me here now. Only you and me. It's just you and me. It's just you and me here now. Only you and me here now. It's just you and me. Make our declaration of trust and faith this morning. And in the midst of all that we're going through, we will continue to worship and bow down to you and you only. Fear would like to consume us at times. Circumstances would like to overwhelm us at times. God, in faith this morning, we declare our trust and our belief and faith in you, that you have this, you are in control. Because of that, we will not be shaken. Thank you for this time of worship. Thank you for this time of gathering. We do not take it for granted. It's an honor and privilege to be able to do so. So this morning, may we soak in and take everything that we can from you and your word and your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. So, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Couple of tags to some things that Angela said this morning in terms of just information. This is National Adoption Month. Did you know that? November is National Adoption Month. We have several families in the church that have adopted and fostered and cared for other children. Zach and Sarah just got Eliana legally this past couple weeks. Went to the courthouse. She's official. Faulkners have adopted, and they have fostered, and many other families have done so. And so we don't take that lightly. That's a very beautiful picture of God's grace in our lives. We were adopted into his family. So that's awesome. Many of you, how many of you still have a compassion child that you've adopted over the years? Okay. Yeah. We got our, I mean, like they're teenagers now. We got them when they were little ones, and it's just awesome to kind of see that. And just be in prayer for the Vickerman family. Tim and Deb, they are part of the first service, and you guys probably know who Tim and Deb are. They've just had a lot. She just lost her father. And so be praying for them as they go through funeral processes this week. And just a lot of stuff in their family. But God's still doing something in the midst of that, and we are grateful. Just be praying for them. So we have been in a series which seems like forever, but 2020 has seemed like forever, so that's why. But the series has been Jesus is my fill in the blank, and we have placed several names and character traits into that blank, and I feel like they've been good food for our spirits and our souls. Hopefully it has been for you. Jesus is my teacher. That's where we landed last week. And today we're going to expand on that just a little bit. Because if Jesus is my teacher, then there's obviously so many things that he taught. And we could branch off to that and just go on to just different things that he taught his disciples while he was here on earth. And we have recorded in the Word, especially the Gospels. But Jesus is my teacher, and one of the things that I can say safely is that everything that Jesus taught was had an eternal perspective or eternal significance. If you were to break it down, he probably taught mostly on how to live life and how to do life, how to act, how to respond, how to react in life situations and circumstances. I shared with you last week that Jesus taught on love. I was building kind of a foundation to get to where we're going to continue today, as Jesus taught on service, and the primary way to serve, in my opinion, is through teaching all that Jesus taught us by his commands. So the foundation piece to me is love, because love is the pathway to our relationship with God. So he taught on love. We know that God is love. We saw that in 1 John last week. He loves us. We love him because he first loved us, taught us to love the Lord God with all your soul and love your neighbor as yourself. He taught us about faith. Faith is an important key component to that love relationship, because faith opens our hearts up to receiving God's love. The faith the size of a mustard seed can move mountains, as well as receive by faith Jesus Christ into our lives and walk in the love that he has for us. He taught us about sin, repentance, and forgiveness. As a sinner, broken and needing a Savior, again, we receive his love and forgiveness by faith. So those set the foundation for Jesus' teaching on service. If I were kind of, what did Jesus kind of centralize a lot of his teachings around? And it was about service. Jesus said himself, I came to serve, not to be served. He saw a need. He was motivated out of his love for people. And he saw through the eyes of love, saw a need, and he met that need. And he served others in order to open up that pathway for his mission to seek and save that which is lost. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 5. This is kind of where we landed last week. Hebrews 5, 12 through 14. And I want to spin off of that just a little bit before we get into Jesus teaching us in another area this morning. Hebrews chapter 5, 12 through 14. I set this up last week by saying that I got some of the teaching principles from a video from Francis Chan called Dying to Self. Would encourage you to watch that. Dying to Self. And he was teaching on this particular part of the passage. And this is where, again, we spent a good part of our time last week. Hebrews chapter 5, 12 through 14. You have been believers so long that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone to teach you again the basic things about God's word. You are like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. For someone who lives on milk is still an infant and doesn't know how to do what is right. Solid food is for those who are mature, who through training have the skill to recognize the difference between right and wrong. As I said, Jesus' model of serving in his teaching on serving others, I believe the primary way to serve others, whether it's inside or outside the church, is through teaching and modeling the things that Jesus taught us. And Paul, I believe to be the author of Hebrews, is saying you ought to be teachers by now. Many of us have been saved, have been Christ followers for a long time, and we should be making disciples, building disciples, and teaching others. Instead, we come back week after week after week needing to be fed. And we're like babies going to the bottle. We're sucking from the bottle when we ought to be eating solid food. And the reason our lives are a mess is because we don't eat the solid food to give us the wisdom to know the difference between right and wrong. So today, I would want to encourage you in something, and that is Jesus taught us how to use our words properly. So if you're going to love someone, if you're going to serve someone, if you're going to walk with someone and teach them what Jesus taught you, then your words are critical. I don't know if you're familiar with this phrase or not, but in the daycare we used it often, and those with small children probably still use it often. When you have a child that breaks down emotionally and starts throwing a fit or a tantrum or just crying for whatever reason, maybe they got hurt, you stop and they can't understand what they're saying because they're crying and they're whatever and wah, and you stop and you say, use your words. Use your words. I can't understand you. Use your words. There is a right way and a wrong way to use our words. It's an important thing, and we need to make sure that we pay attention to this, because Jesus himself, here in a minute I'm going to share that, even talks about the choice of his words being very select. Now, most of us have heard the popular scripture, and we've probably heard it taught, there's power of life and death in the tongue. How many of you ever heard of that before? We know that scripture. We've heard that scripture. We've probably heard it taught several times, and it's definitely in our heads. We know that there's the power of life and death in our tongues. But has that information transferred from our heads to our hearts? Has that information gone from head knowledge to heart knowledge, where it actually transforms how we act and how we respond? Several years ago, I read a book, studied a book. We took our staff through this book at that time. It was entitled Leadership Axioms. The book was written by Bill Hybels. Bill Hybels is no longer in the ministry because of a moral failure. And you might stop me just real quickly and say, well, why would you be referring to a guy who's no longer in the ministry because he's failed? Then we probably would have to take out half of the Psalms, because David had a moral failure as well. And just because a season in our life we have a failure doesn't mean that God didn't use us at another time in our lives. The guy penned a lot of things. He preached a lot of good sermons through the years, and we can still glean from that knowledge and that information regardless of where he might be in this hour today. So here's a quote from that book. If someone had tried to tell me, and this is Bill talking himself, if someone had tried to tell me 35 years ago that my effectiveness as a leader would often hinge on something as inconsequential as a word choice, I'd have rolled my eyes and written that person off. As long as I can convey an idea in general terms, Bill says, that everyone can understand, I'll do just fine, thank you. I would have been dead wrong in that assessment. The truth is, leaders rise and fall by the language they use. And let me just say this, folks. Every one of you in this room, whether you see it or not, you're a leader, because leadership is influence. You influence people all the time by your actions and by your words. You influence people all the time. You may not be a CEO, you may not be a high school teacher, you may not be a pastor or a worship leader, but you are an individual whom God has put over a certain domain of relationships, and you influence those people, whether it be your siblings or those at school. Leaders rise and fall by the language they use. And I will say, Christians can rise and fall by the language and word choices they use.
And again, we're going to see this very clearly with Jesus and his position. What did Jesus say about his own word choices? Jesus said that first and foremost, his words come directly from his Father, and he said it repeatedly throughout Scripture. There's about 7 or 8 references here. I'm going to run through these pretty quickly, but I want you to understand that Jesus said, I don't say anything, I don't do anything, unless I hear from the Father first. My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me, John chapter 7. The one who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I have heard from him, John chapter 8. For I have not spoken on my own, but the Father who sent me has himself given me a commandment about what to say and what to speak. And I know that this is his commandment, is eternal life. What I speak, therefore, I speak just as the Father has told me, John chapter 12. The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does this work, John chapter 14. The word you hear is not mine, but from the Father who sent me, again, John chapter 14, verse 24, I gave them, the disciples, the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me, John chapter 17. But he answered Satan, Matthew chapter 4. He answered Satan, Matthew chapter 4, verse 4, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I think it's safe to say that Jesus is trying to tell us this morning, he didn't say anything and he didn't do anything unless his Father directed him. Jesus also said that his words are spirit and life. It is the spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. John chapter 6, his words are eternal. Heaven and earth will cease to be, but my words will never cease to be. Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21. Jesus, the amazing Son of God, is teaching us today that his words don't even come from himself. This amazing unity between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that Jesus literally doesn't say anything. He doesn't teach anything. He doesn't model anything. He doesn't give an example of anything unless it's first directed by the Father and led by the Spirit. I said just a few minutes ago, we've heard the messages on the power of the tongue. We've all heard them. But are we doing anything more than just hearing the messages? James, the brother of Jesus, warned us about that, about being hearers of the word and not doers of the word. Jesus literally filtered everything he said through a heavenly lens. So can I ask you today a couple questions? Where's the source of your words? What's the filter that you're using for your words? Jesus' words came from the Father, led by the Spirit, filtered through a heavenly perspective of eternal significance. What's the source of your words? What's the filter that you use? When I say that, at one time I didn't have a filter. Anybody know that? Recognize that? Ever been there, done that? I didn't have a filter. And the source of my words were from deep within, of a heart that was hurt, that was angry, that was frustrated. So the source of your words, let me just say this first and foremost, your source is broken. Your filter is broken. Your heart is wicked and evil. The Bible talks about that. I mean, it's so wicked and evil. Only God knows deep down what's in our hearts. They're so wicked, they're so evil. Jeremiah talked about that. Your filter is broken because you are fallen and you are sinful in need of a redeemer. So like me, the filter for your words are often anger, frustration, a source of pain or hurt, or maybe just the deceit that the enemy keeps laying a trap for you day after day after day after day, trying to tie you into a lie and a scheme that he has set up for you. So I think it'd be a good idea, as we're just in this moment, Jesus gets his source from heaven, from the Father, led by the Spirit. And it's always got an eternal heavenly perspective and significance. Let's just examine what the Bible tells us this morning. Is that a good idea? And if we need wisdom, I think one of the places that we could go quickly would be Proverbs. The smartest, wisest guy in the world, Solomon, wrote Proverbs. Let's go to him and go to the Word and find out what the Bible tells us about our own words. Proverbs chapter 18, 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. We've already referred to this. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it eat its fruits. That's the ESV. Let me read you the NLT, the New Living Translation. The tongue can bring death or life. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences. I did that on purpose because there's a lot of us in this room that love to talk. Amen? I mean, I love to talk until I don't want to love to talk anymore. I kind of have a switch. It goes for a while, then I shut it off, and I don't talk for a while. But I do love to talk. I can talk to a tree and convince that tree to be my friend sometimes. I love to talk. But it's not talking about just talking. It's talking about talking with a purpose or an intent that's fruitful. Let's go back to the little picture of a child who breaks down emotionally. Crying and throwing a fit, whatever's happening, use your words. And then they go into this discussion and this rabbit trail of about 50 different things that had nothing to do with maybe the incident. Or even better yet, have you ever laid your child down at night and let them do the prayer, and 20 minutes later we're still praying and praying and praying over the same dog who had the same accident with the same foot? So that's kind of what he's talking about, talking with no real intent, no purpose, and no intentional fruitful results. Proverbs 21:23, whoever keeps his mouth and his tongue keeps himself out of trouble. Whoever keeps, that literally means to guard, to watch, to protect, to save life. Back to the power of the tongue, bringing life or death. Whoever guards his mouth can save life. Proverbs 12:18. There is one whose rash words are like sword thrusts, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. The author of Hebrews again, chapter 4, verse 12. The word is active, the living word. God's word is, it's alive and it's active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It goes in and it cuts, divides. But the words from the Lord, led by the Father, directed by the Father, led by the Spirit, have a healing to it. But words that we use often have a sword thrust that cut and maim and hurt. Proverbs 12, there is one whose rash words are like sword thrusts, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Proverbs 13:3, whoever guards his mouth preserves his life. He who opens wide his lips comes to ruin. We could go on and on. James, the brother of Jesus again, chapter 1, 26. If you claim to be religious, don't hold your tongue. You're fooling yourself. Your religion is worthless. You have negated your testimony. Ephesians 4:29, don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. If we had time and we could break down Jesus' teachings, I believe we would see consistent patterns. I believe we would see consistent patterns, and I believe we would see there is a very select choice of words for every situation. Jesus, on many occasions, by his word, brought healing. Jesus, on many occasions, by his word and by his teachings, brought salvation. Jesus, on many occasions, by his word, by his teaching, brought encouragement. And if he was teaching, which we often see with his disciples, there would occasionally be this teachable moment that would arise. What that just simply means is that the disciples didn't always get it. You know what I'm saying? We don't always get it. Sometimes with your friends or with relationships or with your children, again, raising children, there's these teachable moments where there's an action and a consequence, and you can come in and you can have a teachable moment and you can bring healing again with your words if they're select choice words. Jesus in these teaching moments often would maybe question, or he might redirect, But he would never, ever shame or condemn them for what they were doing or not doing. That is huge. So his words were always filtered through a heavenly lens. What about you? What about me? Now get this picture. God the Father, high above all of this. Oh, I just want you to pause for a minute. Just think about this. All of this stuff that's going on in our world, all this stuff that's going on in your life, all this stuff, the trials, the tribulations, the chaos, the COVID, whatever you want to put into it, all this stuff. And we're down here and we're like rats that are just running through a maze, and we're just confused, and we're turned around and we're going back, and we're running all over each other. Have you ever seen rats in a maze? I mean, they just walk all over each other. They're just everywhere. And they're just going back and forth, and they're just round and round through this maze, and they can't get out, and they can't climb over, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. God is up here, God the Father. He's looking at all this. Again, this is where the trust factor has to come in our lives. Is he sovereign, and is he really in control? And can we trust his sovereignty in these times? And then you have Jesus, who's looking to the Father, and he's seeing all this, and he's going, what do I do? What do I say? Where do I go? All throughout Scripture, we saw that where Jesus would redirect his destiny due to what the Father said, led by the Spirit. What do I do? What do I say? I can tell you in a couple situations in my life here recently, just happened to me, where I was in a position where my anger and frustration was going to rise up. And I just stood back and I said, what do you want me to do? Bottom line, I just walked away, because what I might want to do and what I could have done probably wouldn't have been what I should have done. So I just walked away. I didn't hear anything specific. So I'm like, it's probably just best that I just walk away. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to say? Where do you want me to go? Now I want you to take a look at Matthew chapter 20. I want us to look at that together, because it's not only the choice of our words when we're trying to model the example of Jesus, but it's not only what we say, it's how we say it. I love you, honey. Love you. Difference, right? Baby, I love you so much. You are absolutely the most amazing woman I've ever known and seen in my life. Love you. Big difference. Looking into someone's eyes, talking to them directly, making sure it's an intentional, purposeful word statement. Running out the door. Love you. Now, it doesn't mean that we still don't love, but there's a difference in how you say it, right? Difference sometimes in the impact. Matthew chapter 20, we see a situation where Jesus' words were very key, and what he did, in other words, how he said it, made a huge impact. We got the picture here of the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee. And she's coming up to Jesus with a request for her sons. Now, some of you may or may not understand this, but there's a mama bear in all the mamas in this room, okay? There's this mama bear that rises up and wants her little boy or her little girl to win at everything and wants to have first place at everything. You know, your mama does a lot of fighting for you behind the scenes and you don't even know it. So we got the mama bear who's wanting her boys to be elevated up, because this mother of these two boys has been traveling. That's what scholars say. She traveled with the disciples and Jesus at times. So she's seen everything and she knows everything that's going on. And so she steps in and she's making this request and she's jumping up to Jesus and she's saying, and she, by the way, it says she knelt respectfully because she knew her place. She knelt respectfully to ask a favor. And Jesus turns to her and says, what's your request? She replied, in your kingdom, please let my two sons sit in places of honor next to you, one on your right and one on your left. Have you ever had somebody come up and ask you a question and your immediate response was to get snarky and go, are you really serious with me right now? You got to be kidding, right? Got to be joking. You're serious with me right now? You're going to ask that question? It happens to me sometimes, you know, and we get done with church and you know, just had a hard moment of just pouring out and trying to just feed the flock, just feed the sheep, and I'm just emotionally drained. And then somebody might come up and ask me a question about something that's so random that it's like, really? You want to ask me that question right now? So, and it's not that they're having a bad intent, and her intent was not wrong, but you get how the difference can come out in terms of your answers and your responses. I mean, that's not going to be a heavenly, God-led response, right? And so Jesus, again, looks to the Father, led by the Spirit. She wants her sons to sit on the left and the right side, but Jesus answered by saying, you really don't even know what you're asking. I'm sorry, you really don't even understand what you're asking. Are you able to drink from this cup, this bitter cup of suffering that I'm about to take? Are you really up for this? And of course, her and her two boys, yeah, yeah, we got it, go team. And Jesus is like, well, yeah, you will. Indeed, you're going to. But again, I don't have the place to tell you where you can sit because that comes from the Father. He's already chosen who's going to sit where. And those places have already been prepared by my Father, the ones he's chosen. Verse 24, when the 10 other disciples heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. They were pretty upset, pretty frustrated. I'm going to say the filter of their words probably was not a really good filter at that time. But among you, and this is how Jesus takes what, not only what he said, but how he says it into a whole brand new perspective. But it's different with you. It is so different with you. It'll be different with you. You see, there are rulers in this world that lord it over their people and officials that flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you guys, it's going to be so different. Because whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and give his life as a ransom for others. Obviously, in that story, in that lesson, there's a lot of pride we see among the disciples, and especially among the two boys. A lot of pride, a lot of presumption. Very little humility. And have you noticed that in most encounters that we have where the choice of our words is probably not going to be all that heavenly, we're usually dealing with a pride issue. Pride becomes the most biggest defect of character in our lives. Pride is tied to self-sufficiency, and pride builds up walls, and pride begins to shift and blame, and pride begins to do all kinds of crazy things in our lives. It certainly takes the humility and throws it out the door. So whether it's with our children or whether with it's someone else, the pride tends to take over, and then the filter gets distorted. So in this situation, we see that Jesus calmly taught them. He validated them. You're not like that, guys. You're different. It's going to be different with you. And it's not to say that Jesus didn't have words of rebuke or words of correction throughout his time here on earth. Certainly he did. He had that righteous indignation that rose up against those in the temple who were buying and selling, and he turned over tables. But every time Jesus taught, every time Jesus served, every time Jesus chose words, they were filtered through an eternal heavenly perspective. So I want you to think about this morning for yourself. Those of you with kids, this is always so huge. Because I'm going to tell you, when it came to raising our kids, my choice of words probably fell off the charts all the time as failure. I didn't always use a good choice of words. The filter was very broken. There was a lot of frustration, a lot of anger. Not necessarily towards them, but the anger and frustration that I was having in my own life and in my own discontent and in my job setting and in the ministry setting. Then as soon as they pulled that right trigger, they got it. Anybody understand? Any ever been a recipient? As soon as they touched that right button, and man, kids know how to do that. I've never in my life seen how they do that, but they just know it. I think dad's about ready to pop. Let's just go ahead and push the button. I think mom's about ready to go over edge. Let's just go ahead and pull that Jenga piece out. Let's see what happens. They're just smart enough, and they're just naive enough, and they're just kids. You know, if you're married, then you know that hard day, and you've been at it all day long, and you walk in the house, and you have a certain expectation, and your spouse has a certain expectation, and you have this expectation, your spouse has got this expectation, or vice versa, and you come in, and those unexpected expectations that are really weird and strange, and boom, collision. The words come out. The filter's broken because you're tired, you're exhausted, you don't have any more patience left. You have just given everything you had at work. And the last thing you need is, and the words come out of a broken filter, a bad lens that has no eternal perspective or heavenly perspective. I want to again charge you this morning. I want to challenge you this morning that Jesus charged us in the Great Commission to teach others what He has taught us. Go and make disciples. That's even in talking about raising your kids. That's talking about even in your relationship with your spouse. That's talking about in your relationship with one another. The iron sharpens iron. We're making disciples. We're encouraging. We're helping. We're building up. And Jesus' words brought encouragement and healing and love and peace and hope and faith and joy and kindness and gentleness, because every word was select from heaven, right for what it needed to be. Now, I realize Jesus is perfect and we're not, but it certainly doesn't mean that we don't strive for excellence and strive for a better standard for ourselves. Because every word that does proceed out of your mouth, if it's not the word of God, you just got to realize you're influencing someone and you're teaching someone. Your words, my words, they have power. Are they sword thrusts or do they bring healing? If you don't think there's a significance in words and word choices, what do you think's been going on the last 3 months with the election process? Do you think there were select word choices? Now, again, not of them, probably very few of them filtered through a heavenly perspective, but very carefully chosen, selected words to influence a culture. That ought to speak volumes to us as Christians, as Christ followers. James, the brother of Jesus, also said something else about our mouth, which releases the words. You have two ears, you have one mouth. Two ears, be quick to listen, slow to speak. Listen to your heart and listen to God. I think those are the angles that maybe James was trying to go for. Listen to what's going on to your heart before you open up your mouth. Listen to God, His word. Listen to your heart before you speak. There's been a couple situations recently where I have been in meetings and I really took this to heart. I purposely sat back to watch and to listen. And the reason I did is because I knew my filter was not in the best place. My filter had some anxiety in it. My filter had just a little bit of frustration in it. My filter had a little bit of confusion in it. And you know what? God's never got confusion going on. God's never an anxious God. And so if I've got that going on in the filter, what's the best thing that I can do right there? Sit back, listen with two ears before I speak, if I speak at all. And both situations, I never said a word because the best thing would have been to do one of two things, either shut up or walk away from the situation. So shutting up was the best option. There's a prayer that our prayer team shared with me recently. I'd like for our guys to come back up. I want us to close out with this song. It's an old song from Mercy Me. Word of God, speak. Let it pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. And in that situation several weeks ago, I've had a challenge with my word choices through the years. So I sit in confession right before you, being very honorable, honest and transparent, and most of you know it anyway. My filter has not always been healthy. And I'll tell you, a lot of it has been self-directed. Anybody understand self-hatred, self-loathing, okay? Frustrated with yourself. I fought with the challenge of being good enough and feeling good enough and all those kinds of things. And often my words, I would think were coming out as anger towards a situation when in reality it was just anger towards me because for some reason I just felt like I couldn't get it or I was a failure or it was not working right or why. And so in that, the prayer team was, they were spending actually some time just praying for me and praying over me. And it began to really kind of settle home on some things. And I've been working on this for a long time. This has been an ongoing sanctification process. For me to carefully have a select choice of words, not only for you, but for myself. I mean, it's one thing. I can give you a heavenly perspective all day and encouragement from Jesus all day long. But then I could turn right around and be sword thrust into my own heart. I wouldn't bring healing words to my own heart. I wouldn't bring life to my own life and my own family. Not that I would curse them, but just my situations. And so this has been an ongoing process, an ongoing sanctification. And then it's like some of this stuff is just like coming up to a place where like this light is just like shining really brightly. And I'll tell you what, that's what God does. He uses various people throughout years in your lives and just layer upon layer upon layer. And it's like, wow, this is, yeah. Because all day long, I can speak life to you, but I can turn around and I can, again, thrust swords into my own soul. So they were speaking over me, and they were praying over me. And then they gave me this prayer, and I want to read this prayer over you. As soon as I'm done, I'm just going to ask these guys to just lead us in this last song of worship. Lord Jesus, I need your help. Anybody with me? I need your help. I am sorry for hurting you, my family, and myself. I repent. It is my desire to change. Help me to keep my mouth in alignment with your word. Help me to keep my mouth in alignment with your word. I want to agree with you, Lord. I'm asking you to wash all my words, words of evil intent, words of foolishness, idle words, hurting and angry words, words that curse, words that have discouraged, judged, complained, criticized, and all the words I have spoken that have grieved the Holy Spirit. Wash my words in your blood and cleanse me from all ways that I have sinned with my mouth. Thank you, Lord, for the blood that breaks Satan's hold over my mouth. Help me to see my words by your Spirit and how they put me and others into bondage. Convict me by your Spirit as I speak and give me power to shut my mouth and listen to you. Teach me, Lord, to build up others, to bless and to speak well of my family and friends, to hold my tongue and not criticize or judge and not complain against you or others. I want to be a blessing. I bless you, Lord Jesus. And I bless my family and all that you have put in my path. Thank you, Lord, for being my example. In Jesus' name, amen. I just want to say one more thing to you. I think if we would just take the one passage from James, being slow to speak, quick to listen but slow to speak. Parents, in raising your kids, I never gave them a chance to tell me what the story was. I never gave them a chance to validate what they were really feeling. I stripped away their feelings for years like, that doesn't matter. That's not a big deal to you. Why are you crying? I never said those things, but my actions and the words that I did often stripped away their feelings of what they were going through in the moment. And I've thought to myself, because again, that's part of the great thing about being a grandparent. You get to do it over again. You get to do it over again. Sorry, kids, we screwed up, but we're going to try to do better with your kids. And you get to hear the pain in their heart when there's conflict going on, and mom and dad are pressed, and they're pushed, and they're all of this, and they got all this going, and you get to kind of just pull back and maybe grab one of them and just hold them for a minute. And you don't have to overcorrect, and you don't have to say anything more. Sometimes you can just kind of be the mediator and just go, I understand what's going on right now. Mom and dad are just blowing up right now, and they're confused, and they're angry, and they're frustrated, and they're anxious, and they're blah, 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 blah. It's okay. With adult relationships, with adult conflicts, sometimes it's just better to shut up and listen. Because, man, we got the words. We got the words. We know how to use the words, but are they heavenly filtered? Are they from the Father, led by the Spirit, with eternal heavenly significance? Often they're not. Often they're not. And I know that sounds again like, wow, maybe I should duct tape my mouth. And some of you, maybe you should. For a season. Or just be quicker to listen before you open it up. I'm telling you, it's the most amazing experience I've had recently. To not say anything, but just listen first. Be amazed at the heavenly perspective you can get. Let's stand together.
Myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, word of God speak. Pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet I hear your voice, word of God speak. Pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know.
this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's all